Я хотел бы начать с того, чтобы поблагодарить вас, Владимир Иванович, и поблагодарить организаторов конференции. Я хорошо себе представляю. I'll switch to English soon. Хорошо себе представляю, что это очень большая работа. Вот, так что спасибо большое. И как было, как Владимир Иванович отметил, мой доклад – это открывающий доклад в серии из нескольких докладов. Почти все члены лаборатории сделают сообщение, и ну, вы сможете составить более-менее полное, не совсем полное представление о том, чем мы в лаборатории занимаемся. Мне нужно как-то отступить, чтобы не загораживать изображение. So from this point on, I'm going to switch to English and speak in English. The study that I'm going to describe today is actually sort of synthetic study. It comprises some solid-state NMR experiments and some crystallographic experiments and molecular dynamic simulations. So I'll touch upon all those lines of investigation. And the work has been done by a big group of people. They're mainly based in Grenoble in France. And really, the man behind the entire project is Paul Schander. He's a very, very talented man. He is the driving force behind everything that we have done. Now, I represent here a smaller group of people who are mainly responsible for molecular dynamics part of the study, and also data analysis and interpretation for the NMR and crystallography part. The work was initiated at Purdue, so Yishu and Tehran Yuen initially contributed. And then a year ago or so, the project was relocated to St. Petersburg State, so the results that you are going to hear about today are mainly the work of Olga and Sergei, who are both here in the audience. And Olga is actually going to give a talk which would be sort of a companion talk to what I present now. We've published some of the results a year ago in Nature Communications, which was pretty nice. It's a high-profile journal. And we have now a manuscript which is ready for submission. We're hoping to submit it in a couple of weeks from now, where Sergei and Olga are co-first authors on the paper. So the subject of the talk are protein crystals depicted here, and dynamics in protein crystals. And normally when we say crystal, it sounds like we're talking about something solid, so something which, you know, you would think may not have any dynamics at all. But in fact, if you take a closer look, this is the protein crystal. And you can see that, you know, there is a perfect symmetry, perfect lattice periodicity in this kind of arrangement. But also it's really the arrangement is kind of a bit, how should I say it? I mean, it's a bit loose as well, and there is ample space here which is filled with water molecules. So in a sense, there is not a whole lot of difference between a protein in solution and in crystal, because they exist here in this native-like aqueous environment in this crystal. And so it doesn't take too much to imagine that these protein molecules actually do move. You can furnish some proofs along the lines of protein function. So imagine, for instance, you have a crystal, and this crystal is a crystal of the enzyme, of the enzymatic protein. And as you know, the function of the enzyme is really very much, very, very heavily predicated on dynamics. So what happens, for example, with the HIV protease, there would be two flaps covering the enzymatic site, the active center of the enzyme. And then they would open up, and the substrate would come in, and the lid would close, and the cleavage would take place. And again, those flaps would open up. So without dynamics, enzyme cannot function. And you can take your crystal, you can soak it with the substrate, with the enzymatic substrate, and you'll see that the substrate is going to be successfully cleaved. And what it means is really the enzyme is dynamic in the crystal, so there is really not much of a doubt about this. Traditionally, when we discuss protein dynamics, we distinguish several different modes. So there is fast dynamics, which occurs on the time scale of picoseconds, nanoseconds. And what that typically is, librations of peptide planes like this, or there could be, you know, rotameric jumps in the side chains, or there can be a small loop which kind of swings back and forth, and this is this local dynamics. This is typically studied by nitrogen-15 relaxation, by heteronuclear relaxation, and there is this long history of studying this in solution beginning from early 90s pretty much. And then some 10 years ago or so, people also sort of remodeled these experiments and applied them for solid state NMR samples, and I was part of it together with Berndrive. So this is well documented. Now there is something that, which is a little bit more interesting than peptide plane librations, and this is slow conformational exchange. So that would entail, you know, a more comprehensive conformational restructuring of a protein. So there could be a cavity opening up or something like that, and that happens on microseconds, millisecond time scale. This is more biologically relevant. And this has been studied quite extensively in solution. And these are the experiments which are spin-lock experiments, Karpersell, Maybaum, Gill experiments. So these are the experiments that have, you know, 40 years of history or so. But they've been adapted for the needs of the protein NMR in mid-60s. And we had a very, very successful run with those experiments, like dozens of natures and science papers focusing on these biological aspects of protein function and so forth, published since then. And just about 3 years ago or so, Paul Shanda published the first successful implementation of those experiments for crystalline samples, for solid state samples. So you may expect that this actually has a very bright future and many interesting insights ahead of us. Now, these modes of motion are typically studied with so-called, I talked about it, relaxation dispersion methods, but this is Karpersell, Maybaum, Gill, essentially. And so the last mode that we're left with is this overall rotational motion. And that's a sort of a defining feature of the solution NMR, because molecules do tumble in solution in a random fashion, right? The amplitude of this motion in solution is kind of unlimited, so that's how it goes. And the time scale depends, you know, on the size of the protein and temperature. If smallish protein, you heat it up, is about 1 nanosecond. At around 100 nanoseconds, lines become so broad that it really is no longer feasible to collect the spectra. And now if you ask the same question about crystal, is there overall tumbling in crystal? And kind of a knee-jerk reaction, you would say, well, probably not, right? Because there is this crystalline lattice, and it really constrains the protein, and it doesn't rock. But then, you know, mathematicians have this type of a joke. They tend to ask, I'll say it in Russian, so, есть ли у слона крылья? Да, есть, они равны нулю. And so if we approach this problem from this perspective, is it the rocking in crystal? Yes, perhaps it's zero, or maybe it's not zero, maybe it's a fraction of a degree or several degrees or something like that. So generally, we should assume there is something. And actually, up to several, we can come up with an estimate up to, you know, several degrees. That's a reasonable estimate, because if we have more than that, that's going to destroy the crystallographic data. So if you have, you know, if you have 4 degrees in the smallish protein, the linear displacement of the atoms on the surface of a protein is going to be 1 angstrom, and 1 angstrom you can still have a decent crystallographic structure. But 10 degrees is going to destroy it. So in terms of the time scale, actually no one knows, so I'm going to get to this during the talk, but that's the first time that we were able to demonstrate how the time scale can be measured. And that's this little cartoon, which is based on the MD simulation, showing how that looks like. So you can see that these molecules have a little bit of a wiggle room, a little bit of a leeway, even though they are confined by the crystal lattice. They are engaged in this type of the random motion. So that's rocking. And now the difficulty with this is that there are really like many layers of complexity, different motional modes. And when you do the measurements, it's difficult to disentangle all of that in the crystals particularly. So Paul Schander had this idea that he was going to take ubiquitin, which is a smallish protein, very well studied protein, actually happens to be also a biologically important protein. And he'd crystallize ubiquitin in different crystal forms. And his assumption was that fast dynamics is probably going to be the same, like no matter what's the crystal form. And then he can focus, kind of get fast dynamics out of the way and focus on more interesting forms of dynamics. So this is what he has done. And this is the lineup of the samples that he has used. This is our own solution sample of ubiquitin, and this is the spectrum that we've recorded in the resource center. So you can see here, of course, the resolution is it has a dreamlike quality, right? Very, very sharp lines. Now, these are the crystals. This is pentane diol. Methyl pentane diol has been added to the mother liquor, and so the crystal grew in the form of this sea urchin, they say, so that's morskoy yosh, like very, very thin needle, which means like for the purpose of solid state NMR, it's easy to use because you crash it and you pack it in the rotor and that's just fine. But crystallographers had hard time with it because they need bigger crystals, so they worked hard to grow crystals which would be a little bit bigger. And these are things that we called PEG balls, so that's polyethylene glycol. And also there was some mass added and zinc acetate to the mother liquor, and ubiquitin crystallized in this cubic form. And then there were PEG rods, so also polyethylene glycol heaps and also zinc acetate, similar crystallization conditions actually. The structures of all these things has been solved before. All the structures are deposited in the protein data bank. These are the codes. So, and we basically made these crystals and investigated it by means of solid state NMR, and actually retook all the crystallography data as well. I'll touch upon it later. So if we look at the solid state spectrum, that also looks pretty good. I mean, it's still a long shot, not quite as good as the solution state, but it's a nice and well-resolved spectrum. And actually for 3ONS, if you look at the how many protein molecules is there in the asymmetric unit, there's just one, which means that all molecules in the crystal are equivalent. And this means that we have just one full complement of peaks, like, well, 76, 72 peaks or so. Now, 3N3O actually has two proteins per asymmetric unit, which means that there are two non-equivalent molecules with somewhat different environment. And what this means in terms of chemical shifts, you can see that some of those peaks actually got split. Well, you see this is glycine 47, and now there are two resonances because the environment is not quite the same, it's split. And this is alanine 46, and again, two peaks emerge here. This makes it harder to work with this sample, and this one actually has like three proteins in an asymmetric unit, so three different sets of chemical shift, generally speaking. Like here you can see it's split three ways. And this means that we couldn't really proceed and do much. This is just too crowded, too many peaks. We couldn't do NMR spectral assignment or anything, and not much data are available on this form. So that's the lineup which kind of mirrors our experimental samples in terms of MD simulations. First of all, there is the solution, right? There is an ubiquitin molecule and a truncated octahedral box, and we've recorded 8 microseconds. And then we've recorded a significant number of crystalline trajectories. And normally, if you look at these things, you'll find, you know, literally thousands of papers about protein simulations in solution. And if you count all papers about crystals, it's probably like, you know, a dozen or maybe a couple dozen of papers. And in principle, there is no fundamental reason why not. Because this idea of the crystal lattice periodicity, it's very, very much compatible and consistent with the idea of the periodic crystal lattice. So it's kind of like a marriage made in heaven. And how we go about it, we download the PDB structure, and then PDB structure also encodes in it all the parameters of the crystal symmetry and the crystal lattice and so forth. So we can assemble the crystal lattice like that. Then we can feel the gaps, the voids with water, and we can say, okay, our crystal lattice is actually the same as our periodic boundary box. And then we just start recording the trajectory. If we are not satisfied with the single unit cell, we can put together like a block of the cells back to back, so-called supercell. That's how. And here is the example of our biggest system. So this is actually, this happens to be just a single crystal unit cell. It has this tetragonal symmetry. And 48 ubiquitin molecules in the unit cell of two different types. So it's 24 and 24, like I said. And the total number of atoms is 130,000, which is a lot. And we've recorded 2 microsecond trajectory using those GPU-based workstations. So 2 microseconds nowadays doesn't sound like much. But if you consider the fact that there are 48 molecules, that's 48 times 2, so like 100 micra, that is very respectable. And, you know, just to cross the T's and dot the I's, our force field is amber. That's the version of amber which was state of the art until, 2014 or so. And now we are also in process of recording the entire set of the trajectories using this latest version from 2014. NPT ensemble, room temperature, and that's the water model, SPCE, that we've used. So now my agenda is I'm going to discuss those different motional modes, fast motion and then intermediate or slow time scale conformational exchange, and then I'm going to discuss the overall tumbling, the rocking motion of protein molecules in the crystal lattice. Now I'll start with fast. So what's shown in this column, this is entirely experimental data. And the axis here is the residue number in ubiquitin, 76 residues. Presented here are nitrogen-15 longitudinal relaxation rates, R1. And that's the order parameter for the nitrogen-proton vector. So that's pretty much the amplitude, like how much motion is there in the peptide plane. And black symbols and red symbols are two different crystals. And so what you can tell by just, looking at the graph like this, is that overall, the two crystals show a pretty similar behavior. There are certainly some differences. So for instance, this residue Q62, or this residue G10, and the differences are associated with the loops on the surface. And those loops are sometimes, like in solution, well, in one crystal they would be kind of mobile, and in the other crystal they happen to be, the motion is arrested by a crystal contact. And so we can rationalize that. But by and large, if we look throughout this region, we see a pretty good agreement. And this makes sense because this fast motion is dictated by the architecture of the protein. So something that's in the alpha helix right here, for example, is less mobile, and something that's in the loop is more mobile, so that's pretty trivial. And the same pretty good degree of agreement we observe for the order parameters. Now, if we turn to molecular dynamics simulation, we can capture the same kind of picture. So we simulated two different crystals. Again, we have a fairly good agreement throughout the sequence. Actually, if we compare crystal with solution, there is also not much of a difference. So that's what we expected, that's what we predicted, and this was part of the plan. So we've been hoping that fast motion is the same across the board. We can get it out of the way and we can move on and study something more interesting. And now I move to the slow microsecond timescale conformational dynamics. And then I'm going to show you this movie that has been prepared by Sergei. And this is really like a beating heart of ubiquitin, you can say. So what's shown here is this beta turn, this little turn. This connects a beta strand, which can be seen here, I think, as beta 4 with a short 310 helix. It's literally just several residues like this. And this movie is based on the crystal structure 3ONS with the MPD crystal. So initially, this conformation is called beta turn type 2. So they are all classified, and this is part 2. And now if I'm going to start the movie and let it play, and if you have enough patience, you'll see the transition. So it's at one point is going to actually flip. you can watch this peptide plane right here. Okay, I need to restart it. It somehow responds to the pointer. So you've seen it flipping, and there is also this hydrogen bond here, which is a signature hydrogen bond. So it really it converted to a different conformation, which we call beta turn type 1. And not only this happens, but there are also hydrogen bonds going from here to the N-terminal part of the long helix alpha 1. So these hydrogen bonds also get restructured, and there is like a whole cluster of residues that's affected by this conformational transition. It has been discovered in ubiquitin relatively recently. Until 2011, people didn't really suspect that something like this is going on here. Let me play it once again. If we can just pay attention to those graphs, a little animation that was made by Sergei. So on top here, we see the torsional angle. And this is really the flip of the peptide plane as coded here by this graph. What we see here is the chemical shift. So how we calculate chemical shift? We take this MD trajectory, we take frame by frame, we feed it into the program which calculates and predicts chemical shifts. And then pretty much we plot the data, we obtain this time trace of the chemical shift during the course of the trajectory. And then not surprisingly, you know, we're focusing on this amide of residue R54. Now it was initially not hydrogen bonded, then after the transition it is hydrogen bonded and chemical shift responds. So here on average it's about 118 ppm, and then there is this transition and it shifts to about 120, is about like 2 ppm chemical shift change. Then you know what happens when you have your chemical shift dynamically modulated on the time scale of microseconds. It causes line broadening, right? And the way that this behavior can be captured best and elucidated is by means of those relaxation dispersion experiments that I've mentioned, CPMG, spin echo, spin lock, and you can have, you know, those. This are the experimentally recorded data in the crystals in the solid state, and you see those very characteristic dispersion profiles. For this specific residue, it's arginine 54, so that really matches quite nicely what we predict in molecular dynamics. It does show this behavior experimentally. Like I've mentioned, there is a whole cluster of residues that are affected, so it's like a sort of a hot spot. And then you see a number of residues show this telltale signs of the relaxation dispersion. So this means that they are affected by the conformational transition. The motion is in the fast motion regime. We can fit those data as a pretty simple formula to fit it, and we can actually extract the characteristic time of this conformational exchange. Experimentally, it happens to be around 5 microseconds. And we can draw this at least roughly, the comparison between what we predict in molecular dynamics and what we measure experimentally. So for instance, in solution, what we expect from MD is that beta 1 form dominates over beta 2, 96 to 4, and the time scale of interconversion is about 2 microseconds. Experimentally, we do know that beta 1 dominates because we have some high quality NMR structures. We have a whole bunch of X-ray structures that tell us it's beta 1 actually. And the time scale can be extracted from those curves, and it's 5 micro. So this is not bad. Now, if we move to this crystal, our first crystal, 3ONS crystal, you can see the reversal. So now beta 1 is a minority, is 10, and beta 2 dominates the landscape, 90%. The time scale of interconversion actually becomes longer as the exchange is slowed down. And if we compare it to the experiment, we do know that beta 2 is dominant because the crystal form is beta 2. Actually, just yesterday I've received this email saying that crystallographers succeeded in modeling the diffraction data with alternate conformation. So this is a new set of diffraction data taken at room temperature. And they can actually see both. They can actually see beta 2, which is dominant, the main conformer, the main species, and beta 1, which is at the level, you know, of residual electron density, but they can model it and it's all consistent. The time scale actually happens to be 50 micro, so then you would argue this is not great. That's like an order of magnitude difference, right? Molecular dynamics says about 4, this is about 50. But then thinking about it this way, factor of 10 means, you know, there is a difference in the transition barrier, and this difference in the height of the barrier is a mere single kilocal per mole, right? That's what it is. So you can't expect from molecular dynamics the accuracy that would be much better than a couple of kilocals per mole. So, you know, this is more or less normal. So we can engage in this type of the analysis, and we can tell that you know, our simulations are actually quite consistent with the experiment. And now we've looked at the nitrogen R1 rates, and it's now time to look at the R2 rates. So R1 rho, the same transverse relaxation. And you remember that R1s were very much consistent between the two different crystals, but R2s are not. I mean, you can see there is a systematic shift. So black symbols are one crystal, 3ONS. Red symbols are another crystal, 3N3O. And there is very, very clearly there is a systematic shift between those two, right? I mean, this is about 3 seconds inverse. This is about 12. Kind of like if you think about the base level, clearly there is a systematic shift. So what would be the reason why one crystal is so different from the other crystal? And our explanation for that was this rocking motion. So we assumed that this red crystal, the red crystal, is engaged in this type of the motion. So the amplitude of several degrees, and this is it's sitting there, and it's kind of going like this. And if that's the case, then really you can expect that all residues are going to be affected and all lines throughout this spherical protein are going to be broadened, and that's what we see. So that's what we see here. Now, you may point out that if this is really indeed the case, then X-ray structures should be impacted as well, right? Because this should be reflected in X-ray. And lo and behold, that really is the case. So our 3ONS, the black crystal, which is well behaved, that's a nice resolution, nice crystallographic R, B factors are low, everything is kosher, everything is nice. Now this red crystal, the crystal which shows the broadened lines in solid state NMR spectrum, terrible resolution all of a sudden. Terrible value of the crystallographic R, terrible value of B, is just like bad throughout. So Jacques-Philippe Colletier was involved in this, who is a crystallographer. And then, you know, you kind of have this nagging suspicion, maybe this is because different groups solve those structures and they use different refinement techniques and so forth. And so he took it upon himself to actually retake all this data, reanalyze them, and so forth. And this has been confirmed. Like, there is a whole new set of crystal structures deposited in the PDB. So this is the truth. This is the reality, that the diffraction data from 3ONS are near perfect and 3N3O are lousy. And that points also towards this rocking motion, the shaking of the molecule in the crystal lattice. Can we actually model and reproduce it in molecular dynamics? That was the next question that we asked ourselves. And as it turns out, the answer is yes, we can capture this behavior in molecular dynamics. So what we show here are those dipolar correlation functions for ubiquitin corresponding to rocking motion only. We kind of factored out local dynamics, and this is a technical thing, I can tell you why, but how we did it. But the correlation, those dipolar correlation functions that are normally associated with spin relaxation, they really capture the sort of memory effect. So if you have a correlation function which is identically equal to one, this is no dynamics at all. It's like a static structure. If this correlation function dives down steeply, this means that everything gets kind of averaged in a stochastic way. And so you can see this is our well-behaved crystal, and the correlation function like stays really close to one, so not much dynamics. This is our bad crystal, and you can see that the correlation function sort of goes down quite dramatically. So yes, molecular dynamics can reproduce those effects. I mean, you can also ask me about the convergence of this data, and the convergence is obviously not good, like you see all those curves and they go down, and what does this mean? It probably means that the crystal melts during our simulation. But the bottom line is that we can recapitulate this difference between the stable and nicely packed crystal, which is this one, and the crystal which is not very well packed, which allows for this motional freedom for individual molecules. This is reproducible. This is not a very stable crystal arrangement, both experimentally and by molecular dynamics. And as it turns out, we can actually go back to our R2 data, R1 rho data, and we can try to harness the information that's contained in there. There is an expression which has been published relatively recently, and it's just a Redfield theory kind of expression for those R2 relaxation rates. So it's comprised of the dipolar coupling constant rate. It's the main relaxation channel is just dipolar interaction between nitrogen and proton, and a bunch of spectral densities. And what were those spectral? The arguments of the spectral densities are omega 1, that's the strength of the RF field, and omega MIS is the speed of the for the magic angle spinning, the speed of the magic angle spinning. And what this tells us, what happens here really with this spectral density is, if there is, it's just like with chemical shift evolution. So you have a chemical shift evolution, and then you have a 180 degree pulse, and your magnetization jumps, and again 180, and so forth. So the same story here with this omega 1, which is the RF field, except it's now dipolar evolution. So the vector drifts, and then there is a pulse and so forth. And so if you apply those pulses frequently enough, or in other words, if your omega 1 is sufficiently high, you pretty much destroy dipolar interaction and your all the effects that are associated with dipolar relaxation kind of go towards zero. And the similar is the effect of the magic angle spinning. It just destroys dipolar interaction like this. And so everything looks sort of conventional here, except for this term. And this term has this differential frequency, omega 1 minus omega MIS. And so then you can imagine if you happen to accidentally or by design match those two frequencies, the relaxation is going to come back with a vengeance. If you just think about the structure of the spectral density term, this is going to kind of go back up. And you can simulate it, and the curve is going to look like this. So it's very much like if you are used to standard relaxation dispersions. This is very much a similar thing, except, you know, we are used to seeing this dispersion profile going in this direction. Now it's kind of flipped. It's a mirror. And we're used to those relaxation dispersion things that are driven by chemical shift modulation, and this thing is driven by dipolar coupling. But that's nice because you can analyze it and in the same way as you analyze conventional relaxation dispersions, and you can derive the time scale and so forth. Oh, that's just half of the talk. So we've done it experimentally. And these are the data. So the red points are the data from the crystal, which is actually the bed crystal. And all those residues in the crystal do show one and the same kind of a response. They do show the expected behavior. We call it NERD, near rotary resonance dipolar relaxation dispersion. So they kind of go up. We can analyze that quantitatively. So we come up with the time scale, which is 20 microseconds, about 20 microseconds. That's the time scale of this rocking motion. And the amplitude is 4 degrees. It's really like very much reproducible. All those residues report 3 degrees, 4 degrees, 5 degrees. That's really the amplitude of motion. If you compare that with the data from the well-behaved crystal, you can see like this is flat. This is flat because there is no rocking in this well-behaved crystal. So this all makes sense. Now let me ask, how much time do I have beginning from now? Several minutes?
Only a couple of minutes.
Couple of minutes. Okay, so let me see what I can tell you.
I have some suspicions that it will be a few questions also.
Let me comment on just one slide here. The question that we asked ourselves was this. First thing that we've determined, what's the time scale of the conformational exchange? This conformational exchange that I've showed you, the movie with the flip of the peptide plane, is around 50 micro. And what's the time scale of this rocking motion? And that was determined to be about 20 microseconds. And we asked ourselves, is this completely coincidental? Is it just this serendipity that these two processes run on the same time scale? And we thought maybe possibly not. And so we came up with this putative mechanism of how those two things can be coupled. And I'll show you this other movie here, which is going to be pretty quick. So what this movie is going to show, there are two molecules and they are excised from the crystal. So in fact, there are like 48 of them. There is this all this crystal arrangement here. But we just pulled out a couple. And here we have this beta turn, which interconverts between beta 1 and beta 2. And here we have a side chain, which is lysine 11. And this side chain from a neighboring molecule is actually going to make a contact to the aspartic acid side chain, which belongs to this beta turn. And that is going to have consequences, because formation of the salt bridge would actually cause the flip of the peptide plane here, and it would also cause this rocking motion. You'll see how the entire molecule is going to undergo this, this type of a process. So let me just start it. And you can, you can watch this peptide plane here. I think I didn't catch it, but it actually flipped. And there is this salt bridge which is formed. And now you see that the molecule starts moving like this. So this was our thought of how the two things that were seemingly unrelated, the conformational exchange and the overall rocking motion, can in fact be coupled, and we verified it by a series of simulations, including the simulations of the mutants that Olga is going to tell you more. And now I'm going to go straight to the conclusions maybe and summarize this quickly. So rocking motion that I talked about, it ruins both solid state NMR spectra and X-ray data. The motion is bad for your spectroscopy. So in the NMR spectra, it causes broad lines. In crystallography, it causes smeared diffraction patterns. You can no longer work with this spectral data. Then we felt that there is actually a degree of cooperativity between rocking and internal conformational exchange. And we feel that it's probably a fairly general situation. Because what happens here, this is a little cartoon which I borrowed from a paper by Colin Smith. So this is my beta turn, and it kind of flips like this. And it causes the entire molecule to become reshaped a little bit. Not a whole lot. This is like, you know, about one angstrom. And when the molecule becomes reshaped, it also tends to get repacked. So think about crystal lattice, and then all of a sudden the molecule becomes reshaped a little bit, and it gets repacked now in the crystal lattice. And this is rocking motion, so that's not very surprising. Now, if you want to measure the effects of this rocking motion, there is nothing to be seen on R1, couple percent effect on other parameters, but line widths for sure, then these dipolar dispersions for sure, and X-ray is certainly sensitive to this. And I would like to tout the advantages of this new dipolar relaxation dispersions. I think they're quite wonderful, because when we measure the standard relaxation dispersions based on chemical shifts, it's pretty difficult to actually relate it to the geometry changes, to the changes in the conformation. But with dipolar dispersion, it's much more straightforward, which is nice. I didn't talk about it too much, but basically what our results show is that we can use molecular dynamics to rationalize what's happening with the crystals and possibly even, you know, guide the design of protein crystals, engineer more stable crystals. And we've actually made these samples and crystallized them, and we're in process of investigating those crystals experimentally. And maybe as a last couple of words, I'll say that, you know, it often happens with crystallographers that they crystallize their protein and the crystal looks real good under the microscope, and they take it to the beam line and then they see nothing and they don't know what it is, and they just you know, throw away this crystal and start all over again and never publish, because that's our culture, that we don't publish negative results. So now I think to a significant degree, we do know what's happening with those crystal, and maybe rocking motion is the culprit and something to blame. And with this, I would like to draw a line. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Такой чисто методического характера вопрос. Скажите, у вас там формула для Т1РО, R1РО. Можно я к ней вернуться?
Я тоже не
понимаю. Да. Ну вот, 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 смотрите, у вас там R в кубе. Это мне не очень нравится, потому что R должно быть, мне кажется, в шестой. Или я чего-то не знаю вот здесь.
А вот квадрат.
Да.
Куб в шестую попадает.
Да, куб должен быть в шестой.
А вот она и есть. Вот здесь она в кубе, а здесь...
А, вот туда, а, вот туда ее поставили, да?
Да?
Но тогда гамма получается что-то лишковато, нет?
Нет,
нормально,
гамма в квадрате.
Да? Ага, хорошо. Ага, спасибо.
But I'd like to ask you about this formula. I don't remember exactly about this process, but I wonder why we have here this term, mm-hmm. because the relaxation of proton relaxation.
No, no. Nitrogen. Nitrogen.
I can understand if it will be transverse relaxation, spin, but for spin lattice relaxation, even rotating frame, I cannot understand why this term appears physically.
It's a nitrogen relaxation, right?
Yeah. Nitrogen frequency, but relaxation.
No, it's a nitrogen relaxation, not a protein relaxation. Nitrogen spin relaxation.
I wonder why this,
so. I think they both. So if you write the expression for R2, well, you know, there is. If you write an expression for R2, there is J of zero, right? And instead of J of zero, we now have all those variants. So these are relatively low frequencies, right? This is J of zero. And then we do have other terms in the standard expression for R2. And I think, I'm pretty sure, that this includes the whole bunch. So this includes the differential, the sum, and both interacting nuclei.
As usual, the relaxation of chosen nuclei not depend on the relaxation enough.
I think for R1, you are right, because for R1, it would be J of omega H minus omega N plus 3J of omega N plus 6J of omega H plus omega N. But R2, I think, involves both.
For example, in the laboratory frame, we have no dependence on the frequency of another nuclear.
Mm-hmm. I think we do. This expression for R.
But I think these terms belong to the laboratory.
I'm pretty sure they belong to the laboratory. And I think we do have all of them like this in the R2 expression. I remember R1 expression off the top of my head. R2, I just remember it's long. Mm-hmm. And I think it includes, you know, yes, all of these things. Yeah. Yes.
Во вращении с теми координатами есть спектральный компонент вблизи нулевой частоты. Ну, то есть на самой низкой частоте.
This is the rotating frame. This is the rotating frame. It's always in the rotating frame. And you have no zero frequencies. You have only a rotating frame. I think it's completely correct. Yes, yes. Yes, yes. It's in the rotating frame, the relaxation, not in the laboratory.
Yes, I think so, but in rotation frame if you have a combination of spectral density in rotating frame and in laboratory.
And
in laboratory.
And also in the normal field. Not mm-hmm. not only in the rotating frame, but also in the B0 field. Mm-hmm. I think this is correct, yes. But okay, it's first.
Well, you are investigating quite slow motions, and you have quite definite values, like 20 microseconds of this. Okay, 20 microseconds of this rocking, or 2 or 3 microseconds of other type of motion. Well, is it temperature dependent?
Yes, Leonid, they are. They are all, of course, temperature dependent. So what can I say about this? I can tell you that, you know, all solid-state NMR measurements were done at 300 Kelvin.
Okay, so we are talking about the solid-state NMR probe.
Yes.
Right. Have you tried to look at the just normal relaxation without rotating, just
in the static limit?
Yes.
So in the
such slow motions can be visible.
In the static limit, actually, the kind of spectra that we record mm-hmm. are the HSQC type spectra.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So this cross polarization transfer from yes. proton to nitrogen and back. And we need to do two things. We need to do heavy deuteration of the mm-hmm. sample and fast spinning, like, you know, 25 kilohertz is good and 45 mm-hmm. kilohertz is even better. Otherwise, spectra are going to be quite terrible. Yeah.
Yeah. So okay. So this is your view. Okay. Thanks.
Microphone. Yeah.
Oh, yes. Thank you very much for this very nice presentation. I could understand your measurements in the rotating frame and including also P1 field. You can play with these quantities. I have a question to your first part. In the first part you mentioned is the fast reorientation related with conformational changes. It means you have nitrogen 15 relaxation and you have the coupling with protons. But I do not understand how you can simulate, how can you experimentally detect the details of the change of the, say, of the backbone angles, of the diader angles in this complicated system, because you are simulating about several groups. You are not simulating isolated molecules in which you have this reorientation. It means these fast conformational changes. I did not completely understand. Can you comment, please? Mm-hmm.
So just correct me if I am wrong. I think we're talking here about three motional modes. One is, let's say, picosecond. The other is microsecond conformational flips, and the third is microsecond overall tumbling. So which one you are alluding to?
Yes, but you see, if you make the normal relaxation terms, not the spatial techniques, you mm-hmm. have all the different influences are included in the spectral density function. How you can separate the different mm-hmm. processes, in particular the very or the fast processes which mm-hmm. are related with the change of the individual bonding with the backbone in the individual mm-hmm. group.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. You can't. So the thing is, for instance, let's assume like we're measuring solution, a simpler situation, and you have two dynamic processes, and one is like 100 pico, and the other is, for instance, 100 micro, very different processes. So to target the first process, you can actually measure R1 of nitrogen. And those very slow motions, they're not going to contribute because the spectral density. So then you pin down the fast dynamics. And then you measure your spin lock experiment or Carpersell Maybaum Gill. And there you have this frequency J, the spectral density J of omega 1. And this is going to be sensitive to microsecond, but not sensitive to picosecond. So you do need two different experiments to target them separately.
The last question.
One.
Я почему-то у меня вылетело, может быть, я не внимательно слушал, концевые группы никак метильные, и анаштари группы у вас никак как-то не влияют на релаксацию. Или влияют?
Значит, это лизин NH3 плюс концевая группа боковой цепи. Вы имеете в виду? Вы знаете, значит, они важны, они нам очень любопытны. Вот. А в экспериментах мы их не измеряли. От них довольно широкие перекрытые пики. И нужны специальные методы, чтобы их измерять. И мы даже недавно кое-что опубликовали вот в области развития этих методов. Но, правда, не для лизина, а для аргинина мы использовали эти методы. Вот. Но вот кое-какие новые методы мы опубликовали. Вот. И да, но вот в контексте этих твердотельных измерений не делали, не смотрели, не пытались. Нужны специальные эксперименты.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much again.